In this video, we will be looking at another control flow structure for repetition, the for loop. A count control loop is so called because it uses a counter to keep track of how many times the algorithm has iterated. The condition checks if the counter has reached the predetermined value. When implementing a count control loop, you must ensure the counter is updated within the loop. Otherwise, you will create an infinite loop and the program will never terminate. Count control loop can be implemented with a while statement. Here, the counter is a variable named counter and it is initialized to zero. I could have used any other valid variable name for counter. You do not need to name it counter at all. It's just for clarity. Note also that the counter must be defined and initialized before the while statement. After the definition of the counter, then we use a while statement with a condition on the counter itself. This is followed by the body of the loop. Remember, the body of the loop must update the counter after each iteration, for example, by increasing or decreasing its value by 1, if you wish to avoid an infinite loop. Here is an example of a count control loop using a while statement. The program returns the sums of the n first natural number. In this program, the variable counter is our counter, and we want to repeat the loop exactly n times. First, we need to initialize the counter to the value 1. Then give a termination condition to exit the loop. The condition should check that the counter satisfies some constraints. In our case, it should be less or equal to the given upper limit n. And finally, the body of the loop must contain a statement that updates the counter. In this program, it is incremented by 1. Python provides an alternative to the while loop for defining count control loops. Python uses the for statement. When considering a count control loop, using a for statement instead of a while statement is a better practice. Let's look at this new control flow structure. The general form of a for statement is the keyword for. This keyword is then followed by counter, which is a variable representing the counter in this program. The name of the variable could be any other valid variable name, as seen before. After the variable, we have the keyword in, followed by the function range. The function range has three parameters. Start is the first value used for the counter. Last is the upper limit of the counter. Note the upper limit is excluded and will not be returned by the range function. Finally, the third parameter step is the step or the difference between each increment. It could be 1 or it could be more. The statement terminates with a colon. Lastly, we have the body of the loop, which is indented in the same way it was indented for the while statement. To understand how the for loop works, let's revisit the program that returns the sum of the nth first natural numbers seen previously. But this time, refactor using a for loop.
Let's use the debugger to see the different state of the program during the execution of the for loop. So the first step is to take the input from the user using this command, and let's say I'm going to input the value 4. Having done so, I'm going to have the variable user import referencing the string 4. Next, I'm going to convert that string into an int and store that into the variable n, and I'm going to initialize total to 0, which is going to contain the partial sum of the n first numbers. Now we're going to arrive to the for statement. And you can see I put in the watch the function range 1, n plus 1, 1. Here is going to be equivalent to the range 1, 5. Why is there only two parameters? Is because by default range is going to increment by 1. So So in fact, we don't need to use a third parameter if we want to increment by one. It's going to be done by default, and we can use only two parameters in that case. Again, why did I put n plus 1? It's because the value 5 is going to be excluded. So here, if I want to include the value n, I need to do the range to n plus 1. Remember that it's a common source of error when you try to do some algorithm with a for loop. The last value is excluded. So by doing range 1 to 5, I'm going to have the value return to be 1, 2, 3, and 4. So having done so, I'm going to execute the statement of line 4. It's going to initialize the variable counter with the first parameter of the range function, in our case, 1. Then I'm going to execute the body of the for loop, that is total plus equal counter, and then I'm going to assign that value to count total. So we've got now total equal to 1. And we go back to the first statement of the for. So again, it's going to assign the value 2 to counter, which is the next value returned by range, and then execute the body of the loop, and keep doing so until I arrive to the last value of the counter. So now counter receives the value 4, which is the last one going to be returned by the function range. So when I go back to the first statement of the for, what's going to happen is going to see that the function range doesn't return any more for a value, and therefore it's going to skip the body of the loop and go to the print statement. And then it's going to print the result, which is 10, the result I expected.
Similarly to conditional statement, where we construct nested if-else statement, we can have nested loops in Python. Let's try to write a program to draw the output shown on the left-hand side. For this, we will use the Turtle library, which emulates the old Logo language, an educational programming language designed in 1967. The library is used to create simple graphics using a turtle to move around and drawing lines. The first step is to understand how to draw a square using the turtle library. To do this, we have to ask the turtle to do the same thing 4 times. Move forward x steps, then turn 90 degrees to the right. We can use a for loop to do that, as shown here. For I in range 4, turtle.forward length, turtle.right 90. To draw 20 concentric squares, we need to repeat this for loop 20 times, where the size of the square is changed at each iteration. We also need to change the position of the top left corner of the square at each iteration. This can be written in Python with 2 nested for loops. The outer loops draws 20 squares, whereas the inner loops draws a single square of a given size at a given position. Let's have a closer look at the code. In the first loop, notice that range has only one parameter, not 3. It means that it is going to return the value from 0 to 19 included, incremented by 1. Then we have total.penup. This statement here commands the turtle to put the pen up, so we are not going to draw anything when the turtle is moving. Then we command the turtle to go to a specific point which represents the top left corner of the square to be drawn. Next, we command the turtle to put the pen down so we can start drawing again. We use a second for loop, a nested for loop, to create a single rectangle. Finally, and most importantly, we increase the length of the next square by 10. We just seen that we can nest for loops. We can also do the same things with while loops. And you can see both structures here. Similarly, we can also nest loops of different types. You can have for loop within while loops and vice versa. In fact, any kind of structure, conditional structure, selection structure, loops can be nested in each other. To make our code easier to read, we should use a for loop for count control loops and a while loop for condition control loops. The choice of the structure used depends on the problem at hand. So you need to be familiar with both constructs. At this stage, we have all the structure we need to write complex program. In fact, given a certain computable problem, we will be able to write a program to solve it. However, the code will be difficult to read, to debug, reuse, and to maintain. In later video, we will be looking at ways to improve the readability and reusability of our code.